Then my first question goes to Mahesh. Mahesh, there has always been a debate internationally when the investors are looking at investing in emerging economies, that India's tax rates are not competitive as compared to the tax rates of other Asian countries. Globally, we have seen the countries are competing for corporates rather than the other way around, where we saw a lot of US companies wanting to invert and their structure and move to UK because of the favorable tax rates in UK. We saw, as Nishit mentioned, that the FM has pledged to reduce the corporate tax rates to 25% from 30% over a period of next 4 years. What are your thoughts on that?
I think this is a great decision. They have proposed to reduce it from 30 to 25%, that's from next year onwards. Right, and also the proposal that there's going to be a certainty after that for at least 4 years. Right, and this is really in tune with the government's strategy for boosting this Make in India project, giving an incentive for investors to come to India, that India is can be competitive. Right, yes, historically, India has not been very competitive in terms of tax rates, whether it's across Asia Pacific and also across the BRICS nations, right? Because, for example, if you see Brazil consciously reduced its tax rate from around 35% to around 25%. China also reduced it. So in both, if you see in Brazil and China's case, reduction in corporate tax rate had a big impact on boosting investments, right? In China, once it reduced to around 25%, it even reduced the round tripping that used to happen via Hong Kong, right? So investors decided invest directly into China. Tax rates are a little more reasonable, and I think that's what India can achieve, because this reduction is going to be very significant. At the same time, they've also proposed to remove some of the exemptions that are available to the industry. We are not sure what specific exemptions, but it's worthwhile to possibly do it in a phased manner, where with the object being to genuinely reduce tax rates, reduce compliance costs, right? Make it easier for business, for investors to do business in India. And apart from corporate tax rate, they have also proposed to reduce the withholding tax rate on royalties and technical service fees. Mm-hmm. Now this is a reduction from 25% to 10%. Mm-hmm. Right, it was 10% for quite some time. They increased it to 25%, and now they've reduced it back to 10%, which is also great, because this gives further incentive for joint ventures, technology transfers, and because when you have Make in India, you need to have licensing a lot of technology to India, to Indian companies. So reduction in these withholding taxes also is a very positive move.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think my next question is on GAR.
Yeah.
As we know, GAR was first introduced in 2010
yeah.
in the form of direct tax code. And then UPA government introduced GAR under the Income Tax Act in 2012.
Yeah.
Since then, everybody has been grappling with structures, what is substance, how do you satisfy the substance test, since there is no clarity under the Income Tax Act on what would constitute substance.
Yeah.
Has government done anything on the GAR front in this budget?
Yeah, so the biggest announcement on GAR is it is no longer to be implemented from April 1, 2015, that is next month,
mm-hmm.
which was the big fear, because the issue with GAR is that though the government did try to improve the provisions to add some sort of clarity, there's still a lot of uncertainty on how it will impact all the the popular structures for India. Whether you take Mauritius or whether you take Singapore, because as you rightly said, because what is commercial substance? When do you say there is abuse of provisions of law? When do you say something is bona fide? What is round trip financing, right? So there are a lot of terms that are used in the GAR framework, which leads to a lot of ambiguity, and still we do not know how this will impact structures. So I think this a proposal to have a 2-year deferral, government proposed to implement GAR only from 2017. This is a great step, and it gives a 2-year window for investors to gear up to GAR, to see how do you ensure that structures are developed and implemented in a manner that takes into account GAAR, right? And also, it provides some time to the government to provide to come out with some detailed clarifications on how GAAR will apply, some examples to make it, to ensure that there's certainty. Because yes, GAAR is inevitable in today's world where countries are coming together to battle base erosion and profit shifting, right? But what is important is it cannot come at the cost of certainty. There are investors should be able to still plan, right? And I think the, this 2-year window is very good. But at the same time, we need to acknowledge that even existing structures where you have potential investments after 2017 could still be subject to GAAR. Because yes, GAAR, let's say it's implemented from 2017 and all investments prior to 2017 are grandfathered, but still structures that we put in place today and whether investments after 2017 can still be subject to GAAR. So one should always, while structuring, whether it's funds, strategic investments, always keep in, take into account the potential impact of GAAR. And from that standpoint, it is very important to ensure that the structures are not driven only by tax considerations, but there are several key non-tax considerations why that apply to each step in a structure. You know, for example, and this is for a lot of the U.S. investors investing into India. One of the reasons you would need to have a Mauritius or a Singapore-based structure for this investment is, there's several strategic and non-tax reasons, including the bilateral investment protection framework that Singapore offers or that Mauritius offers when a U.S. investor invests into India. And India and U.S. today do not have a bilateral investment protection framework. So that's why there are a lot of non-tax reasons why, a U.S. investor or a U.K. investor for that matter would want to invest via either Mauritius or Singapore. And so it's important to have all these considerations, business considerations, strategic considerations. For example, Singapore also is positioned as a great platform to access Asia Pacific. It's not just about India, right? There are a lot of strategic and commercial reasons why you would want to be in Singapore, whether as a regional headquarters or as an Asia Pacific holding. So important to capture all that in your structures and at the time of implementation, taking into account GAAR. Yes, it's deferred, it's no longer applicable from April 1, 2015, but it is around the corner, and by 2017, it is likely to come to be in force. So important to take that into account when you implement structures today.